Așteptăm de la dumneavoastră sugestii, observații, de ce nu și critici, pentru că cred că ați putut cunoaște specificul orașului nostru și în aceste câteva zile de vizită. Pentru asta vreau să mulțumesc Ordinului Arhitecților Filiala Alba Iulia, muzeului și universității care a contribuit la luarea de contact cu ce înseamnă Alba Iulia pentru cetățenii și vizitatori și mai toți. Sigur că orice sugestie pe care Ian Dei ne-ar putea face, suntem deschiși la toate propunerile dumneavoastră și toate acestea au ca scop evoluția corectă a demersurilor pe care urmează să le facem pentru a face din Alba Iulia un oraș frumos pentru cetățenii, atractiv pentru vizitatori, un oraș care să graviteze și să susțină conceptul de cetate vie, țel pe care noi îl avem pentru cetatea Alba Carolina, pentru a pune în valoare acest monument excepțional, acest obiectiv de patrimoniu cultural național european. Cam asta am considerat că este suficient ca să vă introduc în atmosfera de lucru.
Eu nu mulțumesc nimănui, nu sunt atât de emoționat ca și Eliga, pentru că mai cumpăr atât de emoționată, dar cred că și amintește cu plăcere. Pentru mine emoția sunt de dumneavoastră și emoția mea s-a diluat un pic pentru că ne întâlnim, suntem împreună de câteva zile și am discutat foarte mult despre ce înseamnă viața urbană, ce înseamnă oraș pentru oameni, chiar dacă sună foarte plin și mulți o să întrebe bine, orașele nu sunt pentru oameni. Dar asta o să le explice dânsul, pentru că cartea dânsului de vizită este extraordinară. Din Moscova, Australia, Statele Unite, iar ceea ce s-a petrecut acolo, nu întâmplat, sunt niște lucruri colosale, care eu cred și sunt sigur că o să credeți și dumneavoastră după ce o să-l ascultați, că se pot face, se pot produce și în Alba Iulia. Nu într-o săptămână, nu într-un an, dar adică tot ce construim de aici încolo și tot ceea ce avem, să le facem ca să fie, să facem orașul ca să fie locuitorilor. Să le placă să locuiască aici. Să le placă mai mult să locuiască aici. O să, sunt sigur că o să vă povestească despre cetate, despre ceea ce v-a văzut dânsul, cu bune, cu rele, tot ceea ce înseamnă cotidianul nostru. Încă o dată vă mulțumesc că sunteți aici. Eu îi mulțumesc dânsului că și-a făcut timp să vină la Alba Iulia. Mi-a spus că datorită scrisorii pe care am scris-o, a spus că la celor colegi s-a acolo ca să-mi dea scrisoarea pentru că o să schimb numele și o să folosesc modelul și pentru alte, sau poate pentru alte, dacă e atât de convingătoare. Încă o dată vă mulțumesc și sunt sigur că astăzi va fi, adică este deja, o zi deosebită pentru Alba Iulia noastră.
To visit and to find out the fantastic spirit and civic pride there is about this city. And I can understand it when I've been around and seen some of the good gems you have in this city. I will, today I will talk about livable cities for the 21st century. And my point is really that being good to people in the city, being good to the pedestrians and maybe the bicycles, if you have some, that is a city planning strategy, which is a very good idea to have a livable city for the 21st century. So this is my major point. I will start to tell you about, in a short version, the story of my life. I was trained as an architect in the 1950s, and at that time, the big thing was modernism. And much of our time in School of Architecture, it went by learning how to do good cities. And we were taught that we should have some objects. And then we should move the objects around on a model. hanging over the model. Bingo, this is a good scene. That was fantastic. So I was trained in all this, and then I went out of, it's going backwards. I went out of school of architecture. I was really enthusiastic, and I was going to do all these wonderful things which I was told in school was very good for cities. Then I married a psychologist. And then at once we had other discussions in the house. Why are you architects not interested in people? Why don't you learn anything about people in school of architecture? Many serious questions were raised, and actually we found out that the borderland between architecture, psychology and sociology was completely uncovered. The architects and engineers did their buildings, and the sociologists and the psychologists did the people, and they didn't talk to each other. Then I had to go back to university for 14 more years to find out what they didn't tell me in the first round. And in what I did in this context, can you back one? Yeah. What did I do in university at this point? I really tried to find out how people were influenced by the physical structures and how we could make where people would like to be, where people would not like to be, how they use the spaces, and generally trying to make people visible in architecture and planning because they were invisible at that point. To modern planning, and also the shortcomings of modern planning and what to do now. But first, we can talk a little bit about the good old days, because in all the traditional cities all over the world, city planning was done one house by one house. It was done along the streets. It was done in human scale. It was made for slow traffic. It was made for pedestrians and maybe horses. And in all over the world, this is from Greece. No, this is from Italy. And this is from China. And along Japan, in all parts of the world, the traditional cities look the same, because they are built on the body of young Homo sapiens. They are observing how our senses work, how we can move. So they are made ideally for people to have a good time. That was the tradition, doing it one by one by one, and that meant that experiences for many generations could go into these. So these settlements are full of experiences from many generations of how to make good city. All this was changed around, I say 1960. But some of these ideas, they started early on. But we had around 1960 two major changes in city planning. Everything was going modern. And we had one very dominating new paradigm was modernism. Everything old was thrown out. The modernists, they said, now we have modern man, so we have modern city planning, modern site planning, modern architecture. Everything old is not good. In this process, they forgot everything we knew about people in cities. And they started doing these buildings where actually the objects were the major things. And what was happening here was really, Bobichet was saying that cities are bad, freestanding buildings are good, streets and squares are bad, grass is good, grass and trees, that's good for people. And instead of making spaces, public spaces in the settlements, they started to have leftover spaces between the buildings. So this was the introduction of modernism, and that was a very strong movement which threw away everything of the past. We can say that throughout the history of man, there's been nothing more interesting in cities than other people. We can follow this throughout history, and we know that man is a social animal. I know that all of you have mobile phones in the pocket and check them all the time. But think about being placed out in the desert of Sahara and having your mobile phone and no access to other people, you will not be happy. So meeting other people is part of what is essential for Homo sapiens, and we've always had the meeting of other people, the meet with other people as a major thing of knowing about society, of entertainment, of joy. These little boys here in Italy, they are looking at the girls, and that is one of the oldest city activities of all of them, and it's still going on, in spite of the Facebook. I always thought that when you get older, you stop watching girls, but that's not true, because beauty is beauty, and it doesn't matter how old you are. But when you are too old, you cannot remember why it was important, but it's still beautiful. So, with smaller households, with more leisure time, with living longer, we have much more time in our hands, so we have easily time enough to use the public spaces and use the iPhones and whatever. And that is what is happening. In the 50 years, also in 15 years, where the cyberspace really has unfolded, public spaces around the world has also seen a remarkable renaissance. And that is because we have more time, but we still are social animals. We still, the greatest interest is still people. The biggest attraction in cities are its people. We have got now two new challenges. One is that we must make sustainable cities. It's so that now there are 50% of the world's population are living in cities, but it's estimated that in 20 years' time there will be 70%, 7 billion people living in cities. And also it's been found out that the majority of all the climate problems comes from the cities. So it's in the cities, they should be the first to address the climate challenge. And there is a very famous organization now called the C40, which are the mayors of 40 most important cities in the world, who come together once a year to discuss how they can do something for making a better answer to the sustainability questions. So there's a strong movement for making more sustainable cities. We know that if people walk more, or if they bicycle more, that's very good for climate. But also we know now that having a good public realm is very important for improving the public transportation systems. Because any travel with public transportation, there is an element of walking to the train or the bus, and going home again at all times of day and night. So good public rail and good public transportation, they are brothers and sisters. It is generally believed among city planners that in 20, 30 years, a great proportion of all transportation would be done by smart public transportation systems. And that means that it would be more and more important to have good public rail to support this. Also, it is generally believed that the good old technology from Detroit in 1905 of the motor car, of giving each guy a rubber wheel in each corner, And that is urban mobility. That is generally known now as being a very bad idea for the very big cities we are going to have and the high crowding in cities we are going to have. And it is believed that we can do much smarter technologies than that old 1905 technology from Detroit. And many, many companies are working on this just now. I heard a week ago, I was at a conference where a guy from Siemens said that in 20 years there would hardly be any cars of the as we know them, and he would have shifted. He would not say how it would have shifted, he just said it would change because motor cars, traditional motor cars, is not a very fabulous idea in a modern, dense, modern city where we should look after health and after the climate. More people die of not moving than earlier on died of smoking too many cigarettes. So there's such a great proportion of the populations who are overweight, and that is now the big killer. And so everything is done to say we must change the way we build our cities, because if we look closely, we built for 50 years cities. We did everything to make sure you were not, it was not necessary for you to move. You could drive to anything and drive in here and drive in there. And so a lot of driving was taking place. It was, the idea was that everybody would be so clever as to go up the escalator to the fitness center 2 times a week and sit for 2 hours in the rowing machine. But it has proved that only some people do it and in some periods in their life. If you think of the whole life, there are many periods where you haven't got time or it's inconvenient. You don't. You have the intention to go to the fitness center, but then you don't go. Also, now we are living much longer and it's not so attractive in all age groups. This is confusing. So it is realized that instead of making city planning which invites people to be inactive, we must now make city planning which invites people to be active. And that would be foremost walking and bicycling every day. The doctors would tell us that 1 hour of moderate mobility, moderate activity per day will actually give you an extra lifespan of 7 years. But more importantly, it will be a much better quality of life when you are adult, but also especially when you're older. And it will be much cheaper for society because these old people who are not, who have moved throughout their lives, they're much cheaper for our health system. They don't need that many doctors, hospitals and pills. So it's found that the best health policy of all of them is to make people move every day a little bit. And we can do it as city planners. That's just doing the opposite of what we're used to. We also have from the World Health Organization, that we have found out and shown in cities around the world that data is the key to improvement, data about people. And so I could end up by saying, welcome to the 21st century. And given the fact that there are now 3 books out in Romanian, and I have had the impression here that they are read, they are studied, I have a great hope for the future of the livability situation in the Romanian cities, and especially in Alba Iulia, where I found this great love for the city and this extremely fine fabric where you have this citadel which could be developed further as a fantastic central part for a wonderful livable city. So I wish you good luck, and I have 2 questions. On the internet, I found this on the web page from Alba Julia. I would like to know what this is. It looks a little bit horrible, but that was a big surprise. I will end very quickly by telling you a little bit of a story. I call it the livability test. I was out in Vietnam and I met Mrs. Lan. She was working at the Danish embassy and she's just been in Copenhagen to do a course in the foreign ministry, and she met me the week after and said, Jan, you must have in Copenhagen, there must be a serious baby boom. Baby boom in Copenhagen, no. We have a problem with reproduction. There will be no Danes left 200 years from now. No, she would not accept that, because she's seen all these prams, all these children on the streets, and I said, oh, that's because we had a long maternity leave, and what can you do but dragging your kid around in the city? And then she saw all these kids on the sidewalks, and she saw all these children being transported on bicycles, in the cargo bikes, or on the bikes. They were hanging 2-3 children on the bikes. She realized that in Denmark, when the kids are 4 years, they all learn to bike. This is my granddaughters, and you can see how determined they are, because life starts when you can bicycle. In the kindergarten, they have bicycle courses, so they learn to be careful. My daughter tells me when they are 5, they can be taken with the mother and father all over the city as long as you have good bicycle lanes. So we have many, many examples in our family that the children come 8 kilometers out to our place on bicycles, even if they're small. And now the 10-year-old girl can do it on her own 8 kilometers safely. A Copenhagen lullaby. So summing up this livability test, if in a city you see many children around and many old people around, it is a sign of quality. Because in places like Hanoi, they have many more children, but you could never take them into the city because it's too dangerous, too noisy, too unpleasant. In a good city, children and elderly can be part of the society, and they are seen, and it's not a baby boom, it's a good city. I would be reluctant to take out the cars from the Citadel at the same time as we try to invigorate the Citadel and make more use. So the trick is that it's not to ban the cars, but to tame the cars and make sure there are not too many, and that they are well controlled where they can park, and that they drive slowly. And I mentioned the other day that in Copenhagen we have a system around the city. The city engineer, he knows that this city contains so many cars, and when so many cars have gone in, all the lights go red and you can't go in. It's called the discotheque doorman method, that there is a doorman counting the cars, and it would be good to have access for some people and for disabled people, whatever, but if there are too many, it will ruin the whole thing. So it's something about controlling it, and could not be fundamentalistic and say no, but trying to have a shared life. Also in the residential districts, I think that there's so much known now about pedestrian priority and shared streets, that you can organize the streets so that cars and bicycles and pedestrians can coexist. But then the cars have to drive slowly in these areas. That is well known what to do, and that could be the answer to many of the streets. So they are not mini freeways, but they are mini streets where cars are tolerated.